All right, it's 6:30. Coming with you out of the chairs. I want to thank you all for coming tonight. This is awesome. I expected like 20 people. My name is Todd. I'm from the Sterling Foundation. I co-chair the Historical Heritage Preservation Committee. We are embarking on the second of three lectures this year. Thank you. Anyway, I have no idea what I want to say. I want to introduce you. Because you're not here to listen to me speak. Donna Bohannon, she is the chair of the
Black History Committee.
Oh, thank you. I saw on camera, too.
That's fine. We're all family here. All right.
And joining me this evening will be Pastor Spurlock, or Reverend Spurlock, excuse me. And Richard Noakes, when he arrives.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I do know what I want to say. I want to say thank you to the Sterling Foundation. I really appreciate you inviting me here. I've got to tell you that when I first moved to Loudoun from Washington, D.C., so for some people, yes, I am a rarity from Washington, D.C. But I can see that I have some Black History Committee members here, so if I kind of go off script because of some of the members here, then you'll know, you'll understand why we're a real friendly bunch. Okay, so what was I saying? So anyway, thank you so much, Sterling Foundation, for inviting me and for taking the initiative to work on preserving the history of Sterling, with Sterling being the first area in Loudoun County developed. A lot of your historical sites have been have disappeared, but I will go through some of the information that we have at the Thomas Bolch Library on the history of African Americans here in Sterling. So, you know, my goal is, initially when I started pulling the information together, my initial thought was, man, we really don't have that much information. But then, we do have a significant amount, but we can always do more, you know, do more research, interpretation of the African American lives here in Loudoun County. So first let me start. So just let me first explain to you the organization where I volunteer and where many of, a lot of volunteers who are here today. Okay, Thomas Bolch Library. So who knew, raise your hand if you knew, that Loudoun County has a history, genealogy, and research library? Okay. There's a lot of people that didn't. Thomas Bolch Library is in downtown Leesburg, Virginia. It is managed by the town of Leesburg, and there is the Friends of the Thomas Bolch Library is a nonprofit organization that supports the library by doing fundraisers and providing funds to support programs and just to help the library out to be of service to the community. The Friends of the Thomas Welch Library was established in the year 1995. In the year 2000, the Black History Committee was established. It is a standing committee or subcommittee of the Friends. It's a little fancy. Can we see that?
No, I can't.
Okay, so now I'm not sure about.
Good. Let's see.
That's good.
That's good.
So again, established in the year 2000, when someone made an anonymous gift of $50,000 with a strong suggestion that one of the rooms in the new library be established in honor of a local African American. So with that gift, we have done a lot of things, made a lot of accomplishments, also applied for grants, and with the idea of preserving and sharing Loudoun's African American history. That's us, our mission to preserve, collect, promote, and share the history of Black American contributions to the emergence of Loudoun County. We have 8 publications, research, we've done research and documentation, studies, teaching aids, oral histories, presentations, and our very popular Heritage Communities bus tour. And at this point, I'd like for the Black History Committee members to stand. Lori, Alicia, and Ann. Alicia, can you stand? So, if you're interested in having a bus tour of African American communities, Alicia is your person to see. She's the local shirt. Okay, so. So one of our most popular publications is the Loudoun County African American Communities Map and Guide. This is the documentation, this is the publication that Alicia uses for her bus tour, to establish and develop the bus tour. Here is the map of Loudoun, and you see all those dots? That's indication of either African American communities or strong or large presence of African Americans in Loudoun County. So we're talking about Eastern Loudoun. And here you are, Oaksville and Oak Grove. Here's also Willard, which most people, if you don't know, Willard is now the Dulles Airport. But we won't talk about Willard, just Oak Grove and those two. We also have oral histories. I knew that was going to happen. I said this was going to turn out to be something like a family reunion. Okay, so these are the oral histories, the existing oral histories we have of people from Eastern Loudoun, the Sterling area. I was going to say when I showed that map is that we have a lot of information on Western Loudoun, primarily because a lot of the people who were the original members, founding members of the Black History Committee were from Western Loudoun. So I think we have, as much as we can tell, kind of a full-bodied story. And that's needed here in Eastern Loudoun to take some of the facts and figures and stories that I'm about to show you and find a way to do more research so that you can tell, we can tell our story of African Americans here in Loudoun. So some of you all know, of course everybody knows Ms. Carey. And then, yep, James and Delma Spears, we have their oldest story. So how many people here actually live in Sterling? Oh, that's live right now? How many have lived or are from Sterling? So Eastern Lounge, we'll talk a little bit about the families, land, churches, and schools. Oak Grove, I put Ashburn on here because if you're from this area, you know there are ties with Ashburn. And then Noakesville. So Oak Grove, there were 1 acre lots sold to the formerly enslaved after the Civil War. William Sheldon Burgess from the Bell family. We have the establishment of the Oak Grove Church in 1878. And there was once a single schoolhouse or houses and churches, as the history shows that there, the church, there were several iterations of the church. And the fact that there were members from Oak Grove that wanted to establish a church closer to their home in Farmwell, and they established the a Methodist Episcopal Church, the Monroe Chapel, or initially that's what it was. They established the Greater Zion Baptist Church and the one-room Ashburn School, which is now getting a lot of attention. So at this point, I have a little bit more information that I can read about Oak Grove, but I also wanted to ask Reverend Spurlock if you wanted to come at it this time.
Is that still standing?
Which one?
The one-room school.
Yes, it is. Yeah, so the Ashburn School, the Ashburn Colored School, is actually on the property which is now owned by the Loudoun School for the Gifted. They've been in the news a lot because in their effort to save this one-room schoolhouse, they started a campaign to raise funds to remodel it or to restore it. And then I think it was October 2016, mm-hmm. it was vandalized with graffiti. Yeah. But the community came together, cleaned it up, supported the school and the young people that are maintaining it, and it is now in good shape.
It's just rededicated maybe in August of 17, something like that.
Yes, it was rededicated. Somebody got a question?
Yeah. I'm sorry, and I don't know whether you want to interrupt with my questions or not, but my question is, so we're talking about property being bought in 74, which is just a few years after the Civil War, so after people were emancipated. So I guess my question is, how did people get together the funds to make these purchases and to build the churches and all that?
Well, I think that what you'll see is it had to be in terms of working and earning money, and then also people coming together and pooling their money together in order to. We'll have some more examples of that as we go through the presentation.
Good evening to all.
Good evening.
Thank you all for having us here on tonight. I want to thank Mrs. O'Hannon for inviting me. She invited me through a mutual friend, Pastor Michelle Thomas, who is very active in our community. And she asked if we would come and be a part of this, this great opportunity on behalf of the Thomas Balch Library. I'm grateful for this opportunity that has been extended to us. My name is Gregory Spurlock, and I am the 12th pastor of the Oak Grove Baptist Church. My wife and I moved here back in 2011. We're both natives of Petersburg, Virginia, and so we were privileged and blessed to come up here to be pastor and first lady of the Oak Grove Baptist Church back in 2011. Before I go any further, I'm going to ask the members of Oak Grove, because there are several of them here on tonight, and I would like our membership, if they wouldn't mind standing and let everybody see that Oak Grove is here on tonight. That we was established in 1878. That is an error right there. Just clarify. It was 1868.
Oh, wow.
Yes, because this year serves as our 150th year being in the county of Loudoun County.
Amen.
So we will be celebrating our 150th year of being in existence and a part of this community. In the month of October of this year. So, and I'm grateful that many of you are here on tonight. Mr. Gunderman, who is so resourceful in our community, he puts out information, and Mr. Gunderman will be sending out some information to you about all of the activities that we have planned for our 150th anniversary for this year. But when Oak Grove was started, there was a gentleman by the name of Reverend Robert Woodson. He pastored a church from called Zion Baptist in Alexandria, Virginia. And he came from Alexandria and settled in the town of Herndon. And there were really no Baptist churches at that time in the community. And with regards to Oak Grove, we're in Eastern Loudoun, but where we are, we're literally on the tip of Herndon. So we were more or less a Herndon community church prior to annexation and stuff. So Woodson, he came to town, and there was nobody in the area that were Baptist. And there was one person in particular, a young lady by the name of Mrs. Ellen Thompson. She was a Baptist person in the community, and he got with her in terms of talking about trying to establish a Baptist church. So when they started, it was not Oak Grove Baptist Church when they started. It was called Woodson Mission Church, named after Robert Woodson. And so the name of the church got changed to Oak Grove back in 1871. And because of the fact that we have so many oak trees back during that time, it was named Oak Grove Baptist Church. And Oak Grove, and I have people who are here that lived in Oak Grove, that was a tight-knit community during that time. And a lot of family members who grew up in that area knew one another, and they took care of one another. And during that time frame also, the train tracks were running right beside the church. And train would travel from D.C. over here into Loudoun County, and the men would go and work in the city and be over in the city all week long and come home on the train on the weekend. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you. From Brooks. Amen. So these hardworking families, they pooled their resources together, because the gentleman just asked the question, how were they able, just right after the Civil War? And in our church history, we had people who would give, particularly, and it's written in our church history when you go on our website, individuals, particularly females, praise God for the ladies, amen. A lot of females had a hand in the history of our church, donating their resources and leaving behind insurance policies to get us to where we are. So we stand on the shoulders of some strong women as well as some men. Amen.
Amen.
So, and I'm grateful to be able to be a part of this 150th celebration and to be the 12th pastor, which is a part of this August body that's been on the eastern end of Loudoun. I indicated I just moved here back in 2011. My wife and I, we both moved here along with our children. When we moved in the community, my daughter, she graduated from Rock Ridge High School out in Ashburn. She was part of the first graduating class at Rock Ridge High School. And my wife, when she came here with me along with my son, he's out in the library doing some homework right now, or thinking like he's doing. But my wife became an administrator in the school division. She started out as an assistant principal over at Guilford Elementary right here in Sterling. And now she is the principal of Rolling Ridge Elementary right up the street here. So, and we're just grateful to be a part of this community. This is a rich community. And when I say rich, I'm talking about rich in heritage. And we do know that Loudoun is already a rich community. But we're rich with a lot of heritage. And I'm grateful to be a part of this rich heritage that the Lord has given to us to be stewards over. And especially during this 150th anniversary celebration that's coming up. So we thank you all for giving us the time so that we can highlight a tad bit of our history, our existence. And when you come back into Oak Grove, I mean, you know, when you come back there, a lot of construction has gone on. You see the Wawa in the corner, you pass by the Sheets. And when you get back there, you see all the townhomes and the single family homes. We're back there in the corner. But the Lord has blessed Oak Grove to still be a part of this community. And if ever you want to stop by to worship with us, the doors are open. If you want to stop by to take a look at our facility, because back in 2000, under my predecessor, Dr. Henny Brown, who I succeeded, his son is with us on tonight. He's one of our deacons. All right, stand up and let everybody see you. Oak Grove built a new facility back in 2000, and we've been in that new facility since 2000. And we have over 16,000 square feet of space back there where the Lord is allowing us to utilize to be a blessing to this community. So thank you all for allowing us to be on tonight's program. And Sister Bohanna, thank you as well. I'm grateful for my wife who came out tonight.
And your son?
And my son. Mark.
Yes, Reverend Spoiler, you have a cemetery right on your property, and the church is built around it, and
thanks.
It's got 150 years of history. Can you talk a little bit about how far that cemetery does go back?
It dates back to the time of our existence. We have some old headstones that date back to the Civil War era, and it is what we call our historical cemetery, and we have some oak trees right there where those headstones are. And those headstones are very fragile too. And we have a lot of them still kind of like placed up against one or two trees because of the fragility of those headstones. But we still have those back there. And we still have our existing cemetery as well. But we do have the cemetery that dates back to the time when individuals who died after the war. I don't know of the names per se because those headstones are really, I don't want to say deteriorated, but you can barely see the names and make them out. I would say, and I'll throw some names out to you, it doesn't mean that those family members are back there, but Oak Grove is made up of families. And when I call out family names, the Page family is a big family within the context of our church. Brooks. Brooks, he's here tonight. Paige, the Brookses. Who else are the Newmans? Yeah. So, the Bales. Yes. Some Bushrods. So they all are assembled within the Hogan family, yes. So that's what makes up a lot of the Oak Grove family in terms of our church families. And they've, of course, moved on, married, spread out throughout the DMV and beyond. But that's what our consistency looks like. Well, thank you all for having us here tonight. Ms. Bohanna, thank you as well.
So one thing I want to say, Mr. Brooks, are you the Mr. Brooks that we spoke earlier? Nice to meet you. I have some people for you to meet before you meet. So the other thing, I'm glad you mentioned that your wife is in the school system. That's one of the things. Are there any other teachers here? Just a few. Because one of the things I'd like to do is to ask you all to think about ways that you can use some of this material to educate the students in this area and throughout the county. What type of projects, what type of research, additional research? I mean, you had a very good question about how did the formerly enslaved earn the money to purchase land. That's a great research project. So throughout this presentation, think about that. Think about ways in which you can help and tell the story.
Oh, can I say something? I'm sorry, one last thing. You go back. I'm sorry. And this is rich, though. Greater Zion Baptist Church? Mm-hmm. Greater Zion Baptist Church came out of Oak Grove Baptist. Yes. Okay, so before they became Greater Zion Baptist, some family members and others assembled and became Greater Zion Baptist Church, but they originated out of Oak Grove.
Do you know when that happened?
I don't know the exact date. No, I don't know the exact date, but I do know that they did come out of Oak Grove.
And I know you all know the Noakes family. It's my understanding that Carrie Noakes was a member of the church in Ashburn. She was once a member of Oak Grove, but went to the church in Ashburn. Okay, so our oral histories. We have actually the transcript. Does this name sound familiar, or do you all? Okay. So she remembers the schoolhouse. Okay. She remembers, I believe I got this right, Reverend Rogers and Thomas. Okay. Lula Lutherson. Don't know that as a friend. A Bushrod. I heard you say the Bushrods. She remembers Oak Grove Elementary School, which was, I guess, the more modern school that was developed. But that Oak Grove is really in Fairfax, is really in Herndon. Yeah. But after leaving the school on the church grounds, she went to Oak Grove Elementary. And gave an example of the stop being by the church. She said that her father worked in D.C. He would take the train to and from work. And she remembers them being stopped by the church. Then there was an Odd Fellows Hall across from the church, House of the Lord. She remembers that. And we were having movie nights. She said people from Vienna brought movies to show. And then, how many of us say this now? There used to be trees. Now, this was 2006. Trees in the area where the commercial center is now. That's the way of life. Right. 2006. James and Thelma Spriggs. Now, from reading his transcript of his oral history, lived in Ashburn before moving to Oak Grove, attended the Oak Grove School. He said there weren't many homes at the time when he lived there, maybe 5 to 6 in the area. He remembers an old country store, the church, and the Odd Fellows Hall. So now, he worked as a young man, worked on the farm thinning corn, slicing wheat, cutting hay, made 10 cents an hour. Hey, well, his father made 25 cents. I don't know what year that was, but. And then he remembers that African Americans lived where the townhouses were in 2006. Does that sound familiar? Mm-hmm. I saw that somewhere else in a oral history where people made note of where the townhouses are, that's where our community, some of the communities used to be. And Thelma, she said she was originally from Gleedsville. Oh, yeah, okay.
What's her name?
I don't know what her main thing is.
Shepherd. Her mother's name is Shepherd.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Miss Catherine. Sorry. Yeah. You forgot the Spriggs family too.
She was a Norris. Out of Gleedsville. Gleedsville. And if you're not familiar, are you familiar with Oatlands?
Yeah.
So Gleedsville is a community that was an African American community established after emancipation by formerly enslaved people from Oakland. And Lori, you're gonna have to stand up. I have to acknowledge you, Lori.
Yeah.
So Lori Kimball is the education director at Oatlands, and Oatlands used to be a plantation, is now a historic home and garden, and they have an effort where they're working with and finding and telling the story of the descendants and of the folks that were enslaved at home. I can tell a few descendants are here. And again, you know, the Black History Committee has most of our membership are involved in other historic organizations, with Lori being one. And so we support each other and help each other in the quest to tell the African American history. So yes, Lori, you have to stand up. And Thelma also said she has attended the old school that burned down. But then the new school is by the police station, but that's again the school that's in Herndon. And from reading the history, it seemed like there was a lot of burning down of churches, and schools.
Well, Alicia said they were race after Jim Crow and all that.
Oh, you mean there's an attack?
Yeah.
The old school was a two-room school, okay, and it was up behind the church. Old Grove was built by Fairfax County. The school is today. The original Fairfax County line was on the west side of Old Grove Road, so the church and everything was in Fairfax County. When Fairfax built that current elementary school up there, they moved the line right down the middle of the school, mm-hmm. and now the county paid for us to go to school there. Okay, so that's how that got to be. But there used to be a marker there demarking between Loudoun and Fairfax, but when they expanded 606, VDOT dug that thing up and nobody knows where that cornerstone is today. But it used to be quite visible when I was growing up.
So, did everybody hear Mr. Brooks?
The county store, I think it's country store he's trying to refer to, my grandfather, Captain Smith, built that store in Oak Grove. Remnants of it still stands as you pass when you're on your way to the church. Yeah, it was a barber shop, a beauty parlor, and a grocery store in there that people used to frequent there.
Louise's your sister?
No, that's my father's sister. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Louise.
I'm sorry.
But to add to the thing on traveling on the W.O. and D, my mother and aunt used to go to Howard University, and they'd catch the train out at the thing, and they'd pay 58 cents to take it from Herndon to Rosman, and they get on the streetcar and go up to Howard University. That's the way they travel.
That's wonderful. Yeah. I mean, you see how much nuance we have to the story. And let me just say a couple of more things. I neglected to say where I'm using mostly information that we have in Black History Committee and Thomas Bolton Library publications. So everybody knows, or do you know Eugene Shields' book, Loudoun Discovered, and also his timeline. These are Black History, I'm sorry, Thomas Bolton Library publications. Also, we have information in our tour map and guide. Also, we have a Black History Committee created timeline. It's called A Journey Through Time, Events Affecting African Americans in Loudoun County, Virginia. And also, we have some information in a study we did of archaeological, architectural structures back in 2002, was it, Lori, that was done? So that's the, and then the oral history, so that's one. So the information that you all have, if you first do it for yourself, do it for your family, do it for the community, and if you so feel inspired to submit it to the Bolt Library, that would be wonderful, because it helps people do their own other research.
Or the story of the Historic Heritage Preservation Committee. Yeah. Happy to record anyways.
Exactly. And that's what I wanted to say, is the Sterling Foundation has an effort to record the history. And you've already done one program, which I'm sorry I missed. And this is, like you said, the second.
I don't know if for purchase or just reviewing and library.
What is that?
Some of the books.
The things you just gave
up. They are available for purchase
at the library. Well,
yeah,
that's right on the website.
Yeah, and it's also, you can go to the Friends of the Thomas Bolch Library website to see the listing of all the publications. There was a question in the back. Sonia, did you know? It's your mom.
You said they burned the school down. What year did they burn that school? You know, I know the one that it was burned down when my great grandfather was teaching for a long time. In the Leesville area, I mean Mount Gap, right up at the court between Oakland and Leesville. And I just wondered, because I graduated from high school, I went by the school and I seen Elton 63. So I didn't take a picture. I might have, but I got a camera to have someone. But I wanted to know how many windows there were. I remember she said we had two windows, but I remember the two windows on one side, two windows. They said my brother jumped out the window with one kind of window. But I want to know when it burned down, because it had to be passed early, you know, like past 64 and 65. And then they built another house there, you know.
I don't know the details, but you know, there are people who can help you with the research, and that's another good research project.
All my family descended from my great grandfather, all of them went to that school up in Leesburg. I mean up in Mount Gap. And I wanted to see the school that was burned down.
Okay. So I think is this the Brooks?
Do we have
Snopes?
I believe we already announced that we do have a notes descendant here who will speak. Okay. Any other questions before I go on?
I was just wondering if the slide deck is available.
The slide deck will be available. So, how do you pronounce it? Eads, the Eads and the Ewing Dairy Farm. there were several African-American families living in Sterling. Two owned dairy farms of over 200 acres in size. Okay, next slide. I mean, this has been exciting, because when I first moved to Valley, I moved to Sterling in the Cascades, actually. Okay, so Eads, the Eads family, they were a dairy farm operation located where Countryside is now. So know that when you go over to the Countryside area, that this is land that African Americans owned and had a dairy farm. Shipped milk to DC on the train, the WNOD. And the area was called Pigeon Hill.
Wow.
Pigeon Hill Farm. So do you all understand for Sterling? So let's show some more pictures for those who aren't familiar with Sterling. Let's see if this is familiar to you. Is all of this familiar to you? So this is, it's East Lane. Right? Yeah. Do you remember? Do you remember
the silence?
I
do.
It's gone.
First off, good evening. I'm sorry to be so late, but never listen to GPS. When you think that you know you're going somewhere from memories, don't listen to it, you know. We ended up going the opposite way back towards DC. I'm thinking, oh, this is the right road. And see, back in the day, when we used to come in to Virginia, it was $4.95, and you come down the hill, and there was a hotel, and you get on Route 7, you had to come all the way up through Tyson's Park. That's where I'm looking for. I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, wait a minute. So then I called my cousin, and she said, no. So we had to do a U-turn, come back, and then once we got on 7, it was like, okay, now I'm back up. When I was asked by my cousin to speak in regards to my family, I was honored, you know, to be thought of to come here and share a little bit about our family. From there, growing up in Maryland, but I spent my vacations for summer down here with my grandfather and my aunt. Down on Maria Road back in the day. It was Route 1, I think it was. Route something. But it was nothing but woods and everything. And so I just want to share with you what I'm entitling it called Memories Through My Eyes and Reflections. Upon my research of the Noakes name, and I always wondered, you know, where did Noakes' name come from? So from there, I started doing some research. What stemmed me to do some research was one day I was at my desk at work, and a very good friend of mine called me, and he said, and he worked, he was in North Carolina at the time, and he said, what are you doing here? And I said, what do you mean, what am I doing here? He says, you left your business card on my desk. I said, no, I didn't. I said, I'm here in Baltimore. What are you talking about? And there was a gentleman who was doing some type of display of artwork there for their company, laid his business card on his desk, and come to find out, he had the same name as me. So he got ran and got the guy, came back, we spoke over the phone, and come to find out, he was from the Boston area, but his family migrated from the South. And he kept asking me what nationality I was, and I said, let it be a surprise. So he was like, I don't know. And I was like, well, I'm going to let it be a surprise. But from there, you know, that started me on my research of looking up the Noakes name. And back in the day, I came upon a book, and if you're ever looking for history, I was surprised to find out that the one society that traces family history is the Mormons. And they sent my father this book that talks about the Noakes name and the heritage, and it gives how the different spellings of the Noakes name was. So we got that, and it just gives you a boatload of information. But I started doing more in-depth research on our name. Our name, the Noakeses, came from Sussex, England, from the land of no oaks. There was oak trees that died out. So our descendant came from England. He sailed over with Prince William, who landed in Southern Virginia. And then they migrated. Some settled in Southern Virginia. Some settled, came north. And then from there, because back in time, it used to be spelled N-O-A-K-E-S. Well, as time went on, they dropped the A and made it N-O-K-E-S. And so from there, I kept looking into more history. And from there, I found out that my grandfather, his grandfather, who would be my third great-grandfather, George Washington Noakes, I did some research one night sitting at my desk, and come to find out that his name came from our first president, because they would take the name of their owners. He was a houseman for George Washington, because I was able to pull up his, I guess you want to call it, his list of all the people that he had, all his slaves that he had. And in that list, he had over him, between him and his wife Martha, they both had a total of almost 200 slaves. And George was one of them. He met his future wife, my third great grandmother, Caroline. And they, from that union, I have it here,
approximately 13 children. She wrote a list, and out of that 13 children, then came my second great grandfather, Carl Albert, who was my grandfather Clarence's father. Here we go. I just want to read you something from that list. Years ago, back in 1987, we have the town, Noakesville, which is outside of Manassas, off of 66, I do believe, 28. And years ago, taking us back in time, 87, the Noakeses decided to come together, all the Noakeses. And so from there, calls were being made to and from different parts of the country to Virginia, to my aunt and to my father. He was named after my grandfather, Clarence Jr. And so from there, she asked my aunt and my father, she goes, same question, what nationality are you? And my aunt and my father both said, let that be a surprise. So on that day in June, 1987, we all went to Noakesville, and there was this big parade. There's the Noakes United Methodist Church, Noakes Elementary School. It's like a street. It's just beautiful homes and everything. And we were supposed to meet at the church at a certain time. So it was very ironic. Here you see African Americans coming down this side and the whites coming up this side. So it was like, oh, and we all met right there. And come to find out that the Noakes name, as far as our first names, regenerate over the generations. Because my aunt, on May 20th, 1987, she sent the list of all our ancestors who were born here in Virginia. And my third great-grandfather, George Washington Noakes, and Caroline Noakes, they had, like I said, a total. These are the children, their names. Katie, Elizabeth, Hester, Francis, Rose, Emily, Austin, John, Addison, Richard, George. There's one that we're still trying to figure out. Her writing is, we know it's an O, but I can't pronounce it. And then there's Carl Albert. He was born in 1857 on the day that James Garfield was inaugurated as president. And from there, out of Carl Albert, my great-grandfather, he had six children. He had Carl Albert Jr., Samuel, Katie, John, Clarence Lee, Forrest, and Hannah. And they came about from there that they were all born here in Sterling, Virginia. And with that, by the courtesy of one of my cousins who I think very highly of, she gave me this book several years ago that is called Loudoun Discovered, and it talks about all the black families in Northern VA. And in here is just two pages. I want to read this of what it says about Noakes and how Noakes Mountain came about, where Cascades, Noakes Boulevard goes up to Cascades, I think that is. And right on that hill is where the school sat. And it was to your left in like a wooded area. Now back in the day, you could see just like the front of the frame out of it burned down. Yeah. But it was sitting right there on the top of that hill. And it says here, the community of Noakes, sometimes called Noakes Mountain, or by the old timers called Bridges Hill, was settled by free slaves and blacks after the Civil War. Along with Oak Grove, Willard, Conklin, Noakes became one of the four black neighborhoods in the eastern stretch of Loudoun County. By the waning years of the 19th century, Bridges Hill began to take on another name, used only by black people. The name was Noakes, honoring my third great-grandfather, George Washington Noakes. Mr. Noakes had leased land from the Lencoe family after the Civil War, but did not save up enough money to buy the land until 1901. The deed was signed on President George Washington's birthday.
Mr. Noakes and his wife Caroline purchased 5 acres on the south side of Old Broad Run Road, formerly of Thayer Road, for farmer George Washington Thayer, and today Maria's Road for Maria Waddell from Martha Lenko for $175. The Noakes' son, Albert, and his wife, Carrie Dave, they had 6 children, what I just mentioned. And from there, it says, in April of 1978, when I last saw Clarence Noakes, the one surviving child, he was 88 and the dean of the neighborhood and black families. Side note, I was in Virginia visiting for vacation, and I remember when he came to visit the son of this particular owner of this property. He pulled up and I told my aunt, I said, we have somebody in the driveway. And the man was looking because when they left, it was only 4 rooms. It was the dining room and the kitchen and 2 bedrooms, that was it. But then he added on additional rooms to make it a 12-room farmhouse. So from there, George Washington Noakes and the area blacks who still rented land were farmers, and on the few acres they planted large gardens, corn patch, they kept a few hogs, milked cows, perhaps a heifer or a steer. They lived in small cabins and weatherboard homes and unpainted for most part. None of them still stand. But I do remember that one time when I was in Virginia with my aunt and my grandfather, we went out for a drive. I'm not too familiar with the road, but we went up Noakes Boulevard, Cascades. We crossed over Route 7 where the college is on the corner. She took us down that road, and I'm riding, and so she drives down this road, and my grandfather was like, go down here. And we went down, and we turned right on some road. And down that road, that's where he said he was born. Because in his birth certificate, it starts with Hayesville, which is now they changed to another name, but at that time it was called Hayesville. That's what they said. But he showed me the cabin, well the cabin wasn't there, but he showed me where the cabin was. When these men were not working on their own, they worked for a white farmer in the neighborhood that also cut wood fashioned into barrel stars, railroad ties, implemented handles, other tools, shipped to railroad to Sterling Depot. 3 of George Washington Noakes' sons, Albert, Carl, Samuel, and Clarence, followed their father's example, and were the next buyers of land at Noakes. Albert, Carl, and his wife, Ada Francis, bought a farmhouse on a 3-acre previously owned by Joseph P. Bombach on August 10, 1904, for $116. The couple added to their holdings on July 23, 1910, when they purchased 6.2 acres for $100 from a gentleman by the name of Henry S. Smith and his wife, Maria Smith. On January 17, 1911, Samuel Noakes and his wife, Daisy, bought 8 acres from Thomas W. Grimes for $10 down. The full purchase price was not stated in the deed, but in October of 1912, they owed $144. On June 10, 1915, my grandfather Clarence Noakes bought 10 acres with a frame dwelling for $650 from John Walter and his wife Eliza. Mr. Noakes was able to afford a $400 cash payment on the property. Fred Franklin Tavernier of Sterling told me a bit more about Clarence and Ada in 1977. He says here, Clarence Noakes is living there yet. He worked for me for 30 years. Might have been a little store there, fellow that bought Sam's place. But it didn't amount to much. I guess Carl was the oldest. He worked for me for a long time. I remember his father as a kid, Ada and Carl's wife. She was a real good old colored gal. She liked her drinks, but she really did help people. She had all kinds of ways of doing things, like my mother. When any of us were born, they tried to have her. Whenever anybody got sick, she tried to help. The school belonged to Clarence. He also bought the house that belonged to Carl and Ada and Carl, but they never had children. The community had its first schoolhouse when the Noakes' clan prompted the Broad Run School District trustees to move a shanty to the area about 1917. Within 5 years, the one-room school burned down, but the trustees said that they would build a new one if the area residents would buy the land for it. By then, the various Loudoun school boards were insisting on purchasing plots for new schools. Previous rural schoolhouses had often been built on unused portions of farms and permission from the landowner. Perhaps the school board realized that some of the Noakes and others area blacks were growing prosperous, by lease by local standards. Tax list for 1920 noted that Carl and Ada Noakes' 9 acres was valued at $90, and their home was valued at $150. Clarence Noakes' 10 acres was valued at $80, but the home was listed for $200. Samuel Noakes' 8 acres was valued at $80, and his home was valued at $100. While the area black citizen raised money to buy land for a new schoolhouse, classes were probably held in an unused rent-free neighborhood dwelling. Families who donated $125 to buy the 1 acre for the new school were the Noakes, William Eads, and Austin Fitz, the most prosperous area blacks that lived at Pigeon Hill on the present countryside tract. The Ewens, probably Thomas and Alice J. Ewing of Sterling and Lafayette, and Henry Robinson of Willard. They gave the money to spokesman Albert Carl Noakes, who on April 30, 1926, bought property from widow Dolly Hermes Ayers. The next day deeded the 1 acre to Loudoun School Board. The various Magistrate District School Boards had consolidated in 1922. The deed noted land with schoolhouse thereon now used for a colored school. Thus it appears that the Noakes, the Eads, the Fitz, the Ewings, and Robinson family paid for the building as well as the land. And then in 1929, the Noakes school closed for the lack of children, but in 1942, at the request of Dr. Claude Moore, it reopened. Dr. Moore had some farm help from Culpeper County. They were James and Jesse Fry and their several children. The school mains teacher from 1920 through 1940 was Cornelia Ewing, and the teacher who, in 1957, closed the schools for the final time was Nannie Cole. The Noakes school burned in 1965. For two decades, a blackened shell remains visible. Now, during the Second World War, the Reverend John Thornton and his wife Edna operated a small general store at Noakes. Now, people didn't have to walk 2 miles to Sterling to shop. They didn't want to take their cars because of gas rationing. In 1962, the Thorntons founded the area First Church in its date stone reading First Baptist Church, organized January 28, 1962, built in 1964, founder J.W. Thornton. Locally, the church is sometimes called Johnny Thornton's Church. We call him Cousin Johnny. That's right. Yeah. To make room for commercial structures at the north and west side of Noakes Mountain, a good third of the hill was gouged away in the early 80s and the 90s. And from there, the old Noakes places are gone, and few of the old black families remain. That was back in right after my grandfather died in 1985, that's when we sold that portion to where now Dulles Town Center sits. From there, after that, my aunt decided to stay where the 10 acres sit to this day. She wanted to move, but she wanted to go back down to the area of Broad Run. She liked that area. And then, of course, she liked Leesburg, because we used to call her Road Run. Because she would always be gone from 8 to noon. And she said she didn't want to be out on the road afternoon. But she, she worked for the government for 30-some years, and back in the day, she would drive from Sterling to D.C. And then from there, sometimes she would stay in Washington from there. I have an article that was written before her death, March of 2005, and it says here, it was from the Washington Post. When 91-year-old Carrie Elizabeth Noakes shops at Hex Dulles Town Center, she likes to tell the sales clerks that the store was built on a cow pasture, not far from where she used to pick black girls. But her teasing in the twinkling eyes, the sadness of having witnessed the entire community in which she lives scraped clean to make way for home shopping centers and offices. From there, let's see here. She said, one by one, the black landowners of Noakes Mountain, nearby Willard and other settlements, moved on. Noakes said especially that most didn't make enough to replace their homes. Not a trace of the community, its history, or cultural legacy nurtured by generations of family remains, except for ours. Directly across from a busy four-lane road in Dulles Town Center, next to the parking lot for Best Buy and Bed Bath & Beyond, the old farmhouse, and in the, on the house under the old part, there are log wood frame, the log cabin frame, in the old part. The rest is concrete, but that particular, those, that section right there is log wood. From there stands on 10 acres, the only piece of forest land the developers were not able to buy. She lived there since 1913 when she was just 3 weeks old. From there, the house is beneath a canopy of trees which provide a buffer from the shopping centers 100 yards away, the muffle of relentless winds. Because when you pull up, literally, it's like when you pull in the driveway, you don't hear any of that traffic. You don't hear the noise. It's like you're stepping back in the 1900s. It's just a surround piece that you hear when you pull up in the driveway. Stepping out onto the front porch of Noakes is like stepping back in time. Noakes opened the door one recent day and smiled brightly, her voice sweetened with the unmistakable Virginia drawl. Come on in, she said. 2 weeks earlier, she had just spent 10 days in the hospital with pneumonia. Yet on this particular day, the petite Gentile woman exhibited no signs of recent illness. Her vitality, youthful demeanor, physical appearance suggested a person decades younger. Her cheeks were rosy and her sure and steady. Noakes regularly takes out the car parked in the gravel driveway. She loves to travel. My friends called me Roadrunner. She said, inside the cozy, neat house, she eagerly shared stories of relatives as she gently touched the photos of the parents, uncles, aunts, and siblings. And it says, her father, descendant of slaves, was born in 1890, which is now known as Sugar Land Run. Noakes' mother, my grandmother, was born in 1892, and she came from Lynchburg, Virginia. They had 6 daughters and 2 sons. They drank from the well, as well as they lived off the land. Because back in, I want to say, was when she was like in her early 80s, the Jack and Jill Foundation did an interview with her up at the, I think it's a resort club up off of 15, I forgot the name of it, and they did an interview with her. And from there, they were asking her several questions. She got several declarations from the congressmen and senators. And one question they asked her was, how did you all get along back then? And my aunt very politely, very genteel, just looked and said, we all got along. You know, she said we didn't, the only time that they went to the store was to buy meal and salt because they lived off the farm, you know, because my grandfather was a dairy farmer. So they had the cows, they had the chickens, they had the vegetables and the meat, they had all of that. She said the closest elementary school was in Pigeon Hill, about 3 miles from the house near the current intersection of Route 7 and Cascade is what now is called Countryside. She said her and her siblings walked to school every day in the winter. Their father wrapped their feet in burlap bags to protect against the snow and cold. Today they have buses and cars. She said, children don't know today. She was the eldest, becoming the family matriarch at the age of 12 when my grandmother died in 1926, giving birth to twins. The responsibility of running the household fell on her shoulders, including caring for her younger sisters and brother, as well as my grandfather. Education, the key to independence and financial well-being, played an important role in her life. After completing her primary grade, she attended graduate school in Washington, as there wasn't an accredited school for blacks in Loudoun County beyond the elementary level. After putting in a full day's work, she finished her university education by attending night school at the Department of Agriculture. She worked for the federal government for nearly 32 years, beginning with the War Department in April of 42. Walter Reed was her boss, she said. She retired in 1973, and then she did volunteer work at the VA hospital and elsewhere. She says here that she did volunteer work at the Thomas Bach Library in Leesburg, and she was the, at that time, the oldest member and trustee at Greater Zion Baptist Church in Ashburn, which she attended since age 5. And from there, before Shopping Center arrived, the deer used to be in the road in the property. And she said she just gave up trying to grow produce because they would eat up everything. From there, the developer at the time cut a gravel road so she had access to the house, which was really the only way she was able to stay. Noakes said the developers also made arrangements with the U.S. Postal Service so they could keep her mailbox at the end of the driveway and made sure that her home was listed with the fire department. She loved her mailbox. Don't touch her mailbox. She had to have her mailbox. But it wasn't easy for her, the shopping centers and roads being built. The lone holdout endured days and days of fearsome blasting and construction crews cut away rock. She said they would let me know ahead of time so she could call in the dog, and they would stay inside until everything was clear. Surprisingly, she says, not a single plate in the house fell during the long construction process. The house has an old rock foundation. She said not a dish broke, not a window pane rattled. Now, I will say this, when I stayed there, and she's so close to Dulles Airport, I would be sitting in there, and you could tell when the planes would fly over, but there was one particular plane that would make the china and the crystal rattle, and that was the Concorde. She was like, it must be that Concorde, and I remember taking a picture of it going over with the nose down, and then it was going up, and she said, just listen at my crystal, it's gonna break. But it did. She goes, look at it, and I'd run in there and look, and it wouldn't break, you know. Except for one sister, who she still has. We have one sibling left of my grandfather, who is her sister. She is now 97. She still resides in New Jersey. She still drives, too. She worked out before she moved. You can never find her. She retired. I'll give you a side note on her sister. She retired at the age of 90. She worked for the Department of Navy for like 40-some years. Then her and some ladies from her job, they decided to travel the countryside. World. They've seen the country twice. Every year for about 10 to 15 years, my aunt and fellow parishioners would go to Africa for 2 weeks, and they would fellowship, set up churches, and then the other week they would do vacation and everything. She did that for about 10 years, 10 to 15 years. What stopped her was, it was like right after 9/11, they were in Atlanta heading to go to Africa. And my aunt was like in her early 80s, I think, and she just had on t-shirts, sweatpants, and sweatjackets, she said, and she was going through the metal detector, and it kept going off. And she said, you know, I don't have any metal on me. She took off all her jewelry and everything, and the lady pulled her to the side, and they kept, and the thing kept beeping. She said, what is this, what is this? Come to find out, she had stays in her bra. So, she was not a happy camper. So from there, they went to Africa, but when they came back, everything was fine. You know, and that was her last trip to Africa. That did it for her, because she never had that kind of experience before. She had seen everything, you know. So from there, she worked for the city of Philadelphia as a school crossing guard for 20-some-odd years. So she would get up, go get the kids on the bus, come back. This was her day. She would get up, go across the street, 2 blocks, get the kids on the school bus, come back home, change, go work at the church. Then she would go to the gym, work out at the gym. Then go back home, go get the kids off the bus. Then she would stop at the store, post office, and then she's back home by 6 o'clock. She did that for 20-some-odd years. And then they finally told her, you know, that she had to stop. So she stopped. So, but she's still going strong. We have to give her that. She's 97, and we told her she probably outlived us all. From there, my aunt said in her article, more seriously, she says she owes her health and longevity to genetics, oatmeal breakfasts, hard work, and the love of people. And so she said here that she lived in the family home since she was 3 weeks old. And she said, technology swallowed up Loudon, everything is gone, she said. And that is in the paper, that's online under the Village of Noakes. You can pull that up and you can see that. out of the family, my grandfather and my grandmother, Alma Noakes, Smith Noakes, they had my aunt, Carrie Elizabeth, we called her Aunt Isabel. Then there was another aunt, Mildred, Ada May, Stella, who was the twin that passed, Arnetha, that's the one in New Jersey, and then my other uncle, Franklin, and then my father, Clarence Jr. From there, the twin died first, and then my grandmother died right after that in childbirth in 1926. From there, she told me stories of how my grandmother, we would be sitting on the porch, and she said, this is when before anything was built, and you could hear people coming down the gravel driveway. And she was like, yeah, she would tell us, she said, Mama used to get on the horse and buggy, and she would put on her black skirt and her white blouse. She'd get a little riding gloves. She was a petite woman. And she'd get in the horse and buggy and she would go to the meeting. And she would go out to where it sits now, cut through Atlantic Boulevard to go to where Mount Zion, Greta Zion used to be. She would go that way around. They used to go, that's what they used to call the meeting. And she would tell me stories of how, you know, my other aunts and uncles used to be. And my one uncle Franklin was blind, and he got around more, she said, than anybody. He was a deacon at the church, and from there, she was the church secretary for over 40 years at that church. And from there, my father, he moved to Maryland in the, I want to say, early 40s, I do believe. And from there, we have, he had four children. One of my brothers is deceased, the oldest one, and I have my oldest brother and my sister here, here of the Noakes family, and my great nephew and my other nephew, his son, of the Noakes family. But when she died in 2008, there was 26 nieces and nephews from there because she never had children. And like they say in John 14, 26, it said, it states, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance of all things I said to you. I'm honored to stand here and share a little bit about my family to you. It has grown up so much because we used to say back in the day, we're going down in the country. Not no more. After tonight, not no more. It was, you know, and I tell people, if there's a landmark or a memory that you have of driving down the road, hold on to that. Hold on to that, because on my mom's side, she was born in Asheville, and from there they met, and I'm also researching on that side of the family too, and you know, I learned this from my grandmother. She used to take us around landmarks. She'd be like driving and say, turn at this tree, turn at that tree. So that's what I go by. And so tonight, I'm looking for the tree. No tree. I'm like, okay. And then I talked to my cousin's husband who said, there's a hotel. Okay. You see hotels and look. I have to come in the daytime next time. Because normally when we come to visit, we come to my cousin's family reunion over in Brunswick. When we come this way, we come the back way, as we call it. We come down 70 to 15 and come down and come that way. The only time that I come down 495 is when I go to my cousin's. For Easter, we do it every other year. I go to Chantilly Baptist. And I know to go that way, 68 and 66 and then go that way. That's the only time I get on 495. This is the first time I've been on 495 and over God knows how many years. Shoot me now. I don't know how you do it. I don't know. I don't want to know why. But I don't know how you can handle the traffic. I really don't. And I traveled 95 for years working from my house to Baltimore for 10 years. And that is nothing to compare to what was today. I'm just like, I'm just driving like, you know, but it is what it is, and times have changed. Like she said, technology has grown, but the house still stands there. You have to go up in the parking lot of Atlantic Boulevard and turn left and sit right there at the parking lot, and you can see it. But like I said, if you walk up the driveway, seriously, you will not hear anything around you because of the trees, and because it's surrounded by oaks and cedar trees and some type of pine trees and everything. But it's 10 acres. To look at it, you said, this is 10 acres. But it is. It's 10 acres. And it still stands to the day. And I have wonderful cousins who live here. My one cousin, Cynthia. It's my joy back there in the back. Stand up, cuz. And her brother, Greg, he takes care of the house property. And on a side note, we have one of the, it's down the road off of, is it meant they changed the name? I know that we have a cemetery that the property was donated to my grandfather and them years to my ancestors. They needed it. Tippett Hill Cemetery. And we know back in the day that you could go one way, two way, you know. But now you have to come up 28 and go Old Ox Road and go down, turn left on Pacifica, and you go up, and then you turn left. It's a crossroad. It's a business park on the corner, and then you go down, and you have to look for the entrance because it's nothing but trees, I assume. But because I can see, what is it, the company Yahoo way over here, and then I can see 28 over this way. But that's the largest one of the largest black cemeteries here in Virginia is Tippett Hill Cemetery, and you will see the Noakes's are to the left, and then there's some Johnsons. And then there's the, what was the family up the street from you? The lady that used to be at the church? The next door neighbors to y'all, up the street. What was her name? Glenn's. Miss Glenn, yes. They're buried there. And then the Johnson, and the when you come into the cemetery, you go to the left and you'll see it goes like an L. And it goes, and all my ancestors are buried along the fence line. And then my father and mother are right there in the front with my aunt. She's behind them. And it's still the largest one besides in Middleburg, where my other relatives are buried. My grandmother on my mom's side is up in Percy? My mom's last name was Bowles. Her maiden name was Bowles. And out of that union, they had 17 children.
Wow.
And there's two of them remaining to this day. And so when my grandmother, my mom's mom died in July, I never forget this, July 7th, on my aunt's birthday, who's still living, in 1973, she had, at the time when she died, we went to the funeral home up here on Route 7, Colonial Funeral Home. She had 73 grandchildren and 103 great-grandchildren. That was in 1973. This is 2018. So you can imagine. So that's on my mom's side. So I'm researching that side. I found pretty much all the information, except I'm at a roadblock, but I got to get beyond that. I have to go to the Library of Congress in order to find that information. But from there, they live right here in Ashburn. Mm-hmm. And they're buried up in Percyville.
Yeah.
I think that's up off of, is it Percyville?
Or
Middleburg? Watson. Yeah. Watson, that's where they're buried. They're buried, because I remember driving an old crooked bridge to get to that. But there's articles in the newspaper and online that you can look up. One that she did, like I said, is called Holding Tight to the Vintage of Simpler Times. But if you do Noakes History of Sterling, Virginia on Google, you'll pull up the articles from what she did before she passed. And my grandfather, he died on New Year's Eve 1985 at 95. She died 2008 at the age of 95. So she she drove a month before to go vote. And because she told me, she said, I called her and I said, did you go vote? She said, yeah, they worried me so about coming up here to vote. I said, what do you mean? She said, I told them I'd get there. So she said, I got my coat on and my glasses and stuff, and I drove up there to the school. And when I walked in, and when she used to go to the hospital for appointments and stuff, they would come out with the wheelchair, and she would say, I don't even know wheelchair. She had her cane, and she walked straight to it. And she walked in, and she voted. And then they said, well, do you need a ride home? She said, no. She goes, oh, they gave me some tea and cookies. I said, really? She said, yeah. I said, what did you do? She said, oh, I went to the store, got them to this, that. She goes, I'll back home right here. I said, okay. And I told her, I said, and I asked her the question, I said, did you think you'd ever see this? And she said, in all my years, I did not think that this would happen to see a black president at the time. And she said she thought she would never see that. But she did, and I was honored to talk with her. Because she shared a lot of stuff with me, you know. And but you could always see her. She loved her big cars. She used to have a... she had a Chevy, but then the one car that I remember driving one time was a 1966 Ford Galaxy. Steering wheel was about this big. And she said, go up the road to the nursery. And I said, are you sure this is when I was dead? And she said, yeah, just drive straight. I got in that car, I was like, I was like, oh my God. She said, now just gun it. Construction workers purchased the car, and it was a part that she needed to get, and she didn't want to do it. She still had the original hubcaps to it, and sitting in the car, the seats weren't split. It was like smelled brand new. And so after she sold that one, she had a Crown Vic. And one Sunday, she loved her Ford Crown Vic. She was on her way to church on the back way of Sterling, going to the church. And something happened, a mechanism in the gas pedal. She was going up a hill, and then she was coming down, and she went to go brake. And what happened was the brake went out, and the gas pedal sped up. It locked.
Wow.
And she went flying down the hill, and she ran into the bottom of a split-level house. The two guys were upstairs at the dining room, and all they heard was this crash.
Wow.
And she ran into the bottom. And so from there, and she was like, you know, they got her. She wasn't hurt. She was on her way to church. She had two cakes in the front seat, her shoes, her Bible, and her purse. So when they got her to the hospital, she said, they kept on worrying about them cakes. And they said, she said, y'all can have them. You can take the cakes. And then she kept worrying about her driver's license. She said, oh, they're going to take my license. They're going to take my license. But they didn't. And then she turned around and got another Crown Vic. And I had the opportunity to drive that. And that was just from there to the cemetery. My sister and I were visiting with her. And we went and she said, you go ahead and drive. That thing was an 8-cylinder and I'm just driving. She goes, punch it, punch it. She's like, oh, that's okay. I'm just going to go. But she would get in that car and go, you know. And someone hit her one day on Route 7 coming back. Some young kids hit her in the back after the light. And she got up, she said, no. Got the car, came home. But there was, you know, back in the day, you saw dirt roads, the trees. You know, when we used to go visit for my grandfather's birthday, we would always come down for his birthday in May. And everybody would bring food and desserts, and that's when we all used to hang out, the cousins and everybody, see everybody, and we would come together. That's where I met his one sister, Katie. We have a picture of her. Both of them were tall. He was 6'2". She was about that height, about 5'9", 6'2", also. And we met her. That was in the early 80s. And then after that, I didn't know she passed. She passed, you know, right after that. But that's when we used to come together. She always was in the kitchen. And my cousins can testify to this, that when it came time for cleanup, we would all try to sneak outside. But who got kitchen duty? I did. And so, you know, she would always collect rainwater and then boil the water. My hands never came out so pink from washing dishes. But that was a good discipline. You know, when I used to go stay with him and her, and before he, at the age of 90 and then the age of 92, he lost both his legs.
At 90, he lost one above the knee, and then at 92, he lost one below the knee. And it was just due to, I think, poor circulation, no sugar or nothing. And then when he passed in 1985, he would always smoke his pipe. He smoked his pipe while he sat up. She said he smoked his pipe, cleaned his pipe, sat there, thanked her and my cousin's mom for all what they did for him. And he never would sit, he would never lay straight back. He always lay on his side because of the pain in his back. But that particular night, he sat up and he thanked her. And when the nurse and paramedics were coming up the steps, he closed his eyes. That was on New Year's Eve. And then right after that, that was 85, and 86, 87, that's when they sold land up on the map of Noakes Mountain. So like I say, you know, it's good to come back home, you know, to see everybody. And I miss the church that was there. That was a one-room schoolhouse. And by her being the secretary, I'll tell you this, and then I'm done. She had to go get something out of the church, and she didn't have the keys. And so she said, this window's open. And I was like, what do you want to do? She said, well, climb through the window. And back then they had them big old Venetian blinds. And I said, well, I gotta get up there. So I found something, I stood up, and I crawled up through that window. Oh my God. I told her, I said, no, what? She goes, come and unlock the door when you get it. So then we got the little, but I never forget the little cuts that I got in my Venetian blinds. But she was a diligent and dedicated worker of the church. 40 years, and I'm just honored that I could share some of the memories and history of the Noakes family. Thank you.
I do have a few more slides. You can, I think once we get to, so there's more.
I'm
going to
show you. That's what we have from England. That's our family press.
So this is the Noakes press from England. So there's more to the story. Again, a lot of what I presented here came from the books and the oral history. But you know, once you get into this business and start doing your genealogy and talk to people, then folks just kind of find things and they share it with you. So this is shared with me from Lori Kimball again. And Lori, I can't remember what paper it was from. Do you remember?
I don't.
But anyway, this is about the enslavement period and resistance to it. This is, it says $200 reward, and it's an advertisement for finding two brothers from, ran away from the Subscribers Farm on Broad Run, Loudoun County, Virginia. And so this is, you know that Sterling at one point was called the Broad Run District. So, there's more details here about the way two Negro men, Charles Cook and Joe Cook, and their description of them, the two brothers, $50 reward would be given for each if taken in Maryland, or $100 for each if taken and secured beyond the limits of Maryland. And then all reasonable expenses paid for at home. Then it says the men were seen in the company of three others who also absconded, passing on this day, midday on the 25th from Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, on their way to the supposed York. Any communications addressed to Gettysburg? Okay, so resistance, leaving, running, getting away. So we can go to the next. Resistance, the Daily Log Cabin, and the Underground Railroad, rumor or fact. Remember I said these are things here that we can look at and see and do more research. I happen to know that our friend, Pastor Michelle Thomas, She found remnants of this. And so very definitely interested in the Underground Railroad story and reinterpreting it. So here, this is from our, back in 2002, the Black History Committee and the Board of Supervisors did a architectural review of certain structures around the county, and this was one of them. And basically it says that it was, it says that sources speculate that this early log cabin was built by Quakers and owned by free blacks before the Civil War. And it was thought to be a safe house on the Underground Railroad. But no definitive research has confirmed this because, as you know, should have been a secret. However, the house stands near Potomac River and a historic ferry crossing. The house is located in an area that by the late 1800s was known locally as Notes or Notesville. You all know the rest of that story. So this is what's left of the structure. And there's more information on what happened, but still, this footprint is still there. And it's at Potomac Potomac View and Brown Nursing Home. Okay? So we can go. Cascade Overlook. Remember. So how many of you all know Cascades, the new wonderful Cascades Overlook? I'm there all the time.
Me too.
I'm there. Inside, this is the event center. And inside the event center, there's a plaque by the elevator that says, until 2014, here stood the last area church congregation founded by former slaves and freedmen. Congregants first met in homes, I think you told us that, and at the Notes Schoolhouse. The last church building on this site was built through the efforts of John and Edna Thornton, storekeepers in Notes Village, located on the hill to the south. The sanctuary foundation stone reads, First Baptist Church, organized January 28, 1962, and built 1964. Founder, J.W. Thornton. Carrie Notes remembers. So the other two remember slides that I provided, that was a written transcript. This one was her voice, recorded, a recording of Carrie Notes. It is about an hour and a half, filled with information. So I just picked a few. She said, behind the Ark Church, remember the Ark, Noah's, the Ark? There was rumors of a house, and heard it from my old ears. She said there was rumors that there was a house on the Underground Railroad at 7 and Potomac. There was a big white house on the hill used by riverboat people.
Wow.
That's what she said. And she talked about Tippett's Hill Cemetery. Land given to blacks and Americans without whites. You mentioned that as well. Then she talked about it being a real rural community with farms. She spoke of the Rock Inn being the Eads' house when they first moved to Loudoun. It was a stone home near the nursing home at Route 7. Stones made from the red sand or rocks or stones from the Notes property. She also remembered the Thompson, Ellison, and Jones family. She said she used to play films around that time. And she talked about a church that was part of the Notes property, and now I put that now the Oaks, the Overlook. And she also told a story I'm very familiar with, you know, about, you know, schooling, that seldom getting the new books and not getting hand-me-down books. But then also, she was part of the people, the African Americans in Sterling were part of the effort to get land for Douglas High School. So, and if anybody knows that story, the community the African American community got together and they sold candy, cookies, dinners to pay for the purchasing of the land, and these were for Frederick Douglass High School. Then, of course, as was done during the day, the deed was given to the county. And then there's more to the story, but then that's the Douglass-Leesburg story. So I think that what's going to happen now, that for some reason there's a glitch in the slide. I don't know if you could put it on like Sorter or the original. But basically, that was the end of the slideshow. It's just, I had a few more slides. One, to say that we have a challenge, okay? We have a challenge to tell our stories, do the research, write things down, save our photos, and then, it's very important, we all know interpretation matters. So the next slide would have been the listing of the Thomas Gulch Library resources that was used to put together the information, the shield, and then the Black History Committee information. And also a slide that says, you know, do you want to be a member? It kind of gives you information on the library and how to get in contact with us. And were there any other questions? We have, 10 minutes, and I will have a few announcements as well, but I wanted to, Cheryl, you had.
I would love to know what the plans are for the Noakes family home. I would love to still have a place where you could stand on a porch and it'd be quiet. That'd be wonderful.
I'd love to go see the house.
You can basically drive, you know, down to the shopping center. And you can walk out the driveway across, and there's McDonald's right there. You can pull over to the front of the house in the parking lot, and you'll see the front of the house. From there, currently right now, we are in the negotiations with buyers who want to purchase the property. But my one cousin, who used to drive my aunt around, the day that she passed, she had 3 appointments that day, and he tried calling her, and he couldn't get a hold of her. The line was busy, and so when he went to the house and he walked around the side, you know, the house, the kitchen windows were like down at ground level, you know. So he looked in and he saw her on the floor. She had fell out. She had a heart attack, and from there she had 3 appointments. One was to go to the dealership for something with the car. 2. She was supposed to go to the bank, and 3, she was going to go meet her lawyer, but she never made it. So we're in the process, the family's in the process of talking to buyers who want to purchase it, but we know at one point long ago that she was talking to the area about doing it as a historical site because it's over 300 years old. Because when you walk into the older part of the house, upstairs you have these old wooden pine floors. Not the little pine, but they're wide pine floors. And the whole top floor is old pine floors. And she had those redone years ago where she had them sealed and it looks very nice. But right now, that's what we're in the process of. But yeah, you drive over and look right at the house. And, you know, walk up the drive and there's the front yard and everything like that.
I always wanted to.
Oh, we caught you for you can sit right there in the parking lot and look at it, because if you go into the drive, it takes you around out to Noakes Boulevard. So it's like the entrance is right across from Dulles Town Center. So if you come out of Dulles Town Center, you can shoot across and go like you're going into the parking lot, but then you'll see a sign that says private drive, and you'll curve around.
and you'll see where the old chicken coop used to be, and then the hog pen, and then there's the back, the side of the house, and then you come around, and then it brings you around to the front of the house, and everything. And that used to be, right there, was just Thayer Road. That was just a long dirt road, and it was all woods over there, because we used to run in the woods and everything. But yeah, you can pull over there and look, you know, because my cousin, he keeps the upkeep as far as the grass and stuff like that and everything. But yeah, more than welcome.
Thank you. And I just want to make two announcements. We are going to have, the Black History Committee will have an open house this Saturday. Our themes are, it's an open house to introduce you to the library and the friends and the Thomas and the Black History Committee. We have a speaker, Kevin Grigsby, who you all, a lot of people may know. He's a local guy, local historian who has written about the African American community of Howardsville. And also he's written a book, done research on the up to 300 African Americans from Loudoun County that served in the Civil War for the Union. Up to 300 people from Loudoun County served for the Union Army. And we also have a panel discussion on doing African American genealogy. We had two themes, African Americans in times of war and African American genealogy, that we will do programming throughout the year. So Kevin being our first speaker, but the next speaker will be somebody who lives in Sterling, the Cascades, Mr. Steve Hammond, who's a Black History Committee member. His title is, What Do Loudoun County, Alexandria, Virginia, and Washington, D.C. Have in Common? You have to come. But it has to do with Oatlands, and it has to do with the Sphinx family. Syphax family. from Washington, D.C. and Alexandria, and also there's some ties to George Washington or Martha Washington as well. Ooh, they want to come back during the day.
I know you're coming that way.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you, Sterling Foundation. Thank you, everybody, for being here. I hope you are inspired, everybody, inspired to do your family research if you haven't done it. Write things down. Share your story. Share it with the community. Share it with the library. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you.
On this, not only inspirational but spectacular presentation. And thank you to our special guest for making that trip. But come back. Do come back.
Yeah. Elena, I just yes. Feel like I also have to say thank you to you. Thank you for Cheryl. This was a team effort. Because the Sterling Foundation, they really conceived of this. They supported, they helped with the flyers and the advertisements. They invited Mr. Noakes and also Mr. Spurl, Dr. Reverend Spurl X. So I want to thank you as well.
And you are a hard person to get a hold of. So glad you can make it. My name is Helena Siska, and I am a former planning commissioner for Loudoun County. So when I did not come back as a planning commissioner this term, I had a little bit of extra time. And I got involved with some wonderful people at the Sterling Foundation. I want to acknowledge Cheryl Belova, who is the chair. She was elected this year. Stand up, Cheryl. You are on stage. Thank you to the Sterling Foundation for taking on our group, which is known as the Sterling Historical, sometimes I say hysterical, Historical and Heritage Preservation Committee, which just started our third year. We started off on a very sad note, and I want to just take a minute or so to tell you this story because it's very important. But before I do, I saw my husband getting into the cookies, so before you leave, and he helps us also have some cookies and water, take some home, please. We came together because a very important church in the community was torn down. about 2 years ago. Do you remember the Methodist church that sat on Church Road going toward Route 28? That was a historic church. Okay. And unfortunately, not many people thought to keep it. You have learned here so much beautiful history that is unknown to most people in Sterling, most people in Loudoun. Usually when you hear about Sterling, we don't have a very Sterling reputation, do we? I hope you walk out of here feeling very honored as to where you live, very special, and understanding that you and your children and your grandchildren are a part of history. These are people who made history. You are making history. But are you going to look at this and go home and say, well, that was great? Are you going to do something about it? Because if we're going to save these structures, and I'm so happy to hear about the possibility of the Noakes homestead being saved, will you get involved in some way with the Sterling Foundation and with the SHHPC? Now, we're very casual about things. You know, we don't have envelopes to pass around. But if you would like to help us with a donation, just look up the Sterling Foundation and send in your $20 membership. And the foundation takes care of the creeks in the community. They do a lot of cleanup. All of Sterling Boulevard, the maintenance of Sterling Boulevard, is not done by VDOT. Okay, it's done by the foundation. And our role here is to just give you all a portrait of how wonderful you all are. But we need your help with financial donations, but more importantly, we need you. We need you to get involved with the foundation and with the Historical Preservation Committee. So if after you've seen this, you liked what you saw and could devote anywhere from an hour to several hours, you know, during the year to help us try to get the word out about your community, please see me or Todd or Mark or my husband Mark, who likes cookies over there in the corner. You know, we have to eat them all. No, I'm serious. He likes them all. But I also want to relate something else that my husband and I recently discovered. We own a little property in Richmond. And we usually go down for long weekends. And it turned out that if you go to Richmond on a Monday, everything historical is closed. Okay? It's closed. So if you want to visit Richmond, don't go on a Monday. But on one particular Monday, there was a building that was open. How many of you here have heard of Maggie Walker? Oh, bravo, bravo. Who's Maggie Walker? Who is Maggie Walker?
A woman who had the hair product business?
No, no. She started the first African-American bank, and many people don't know this. She was the first woman banker in the country. Okay? If you go to Richmond, we found her house. Read of her story. Read of the history of what it took to make her home now a national monument. And if the Maggie Walker family could do it, and I will tell you, that is a family of great tragedy. Tragedy. Two sons, one son accidentally killed his father. She was self-learned. She had a library, and everything she learned was from the books that she bought. Started the first bank. She, to me, is a role model. And we have our beautiful history here. We can do as they have done in Richmond, as they have done in Leesburg, and in Ashburn. We just need your help. So I want to thank you all. You really are making history by coming here. I think we counted 93 people. Our first lecture in the fall, we have the old timers from Old Sterling, okay, who lived along the W and O D. And they told all the stories of how, you know, they would cross Route 28 when it was just a one-lane road, two-lane road. They talked about the train, the stories that Donna was talking about and you all were talking about today, how people got on the train, how they would, for 15 cents, get on the train and go to D.C. for the day. Okay. God help us with Metro, but that's another story. We will have the last lecture of our series for the year on April the 11th. It is on the WNOD. It is an excellent lecture with so many phenomenal photos. I have personally seen it in the city of Fairfax. It was standing room only. I hope we can do the same here in Sterling. So come back on April the 11th. And again, congratulations to you all for coming here. You all are great.
What's our website?
It's www.sterlingfoundation.org.
Okay, sterlingfoundation.org.
And Elena, you did record your first lecture as well, right?
Yes, and we're recording this one as well. And we have some support from Northern Virginia Community College. They're very interested in what we're doing. Lori, wonderful to have you here. Where are you, Lori? There you are. Okay. Lori, wonderful to have you here this evening. Please enjoy the water and the cookies. And again, thank you for coming. And we ask our guests to hang around for a few minutes while we take some photos. Thank you all.